We're looking at Mounts chapter 14 on relative pronouns. Okay, now relative pronouns are going to be used to introduce relative clauses, and it wouldn't be a bad idea to just remind ourselves what relative clauses are. Relative clauses are clauses that introduce or that are introduced by the words who, which, or that, right? So that's what relative clauses are, who, which, or that clauses. I know the man who came to dinner, right? This is the pencil that fell on the ground. I love the woman whom Michael Horton had dinner with some night. So I use who, which, that to introduce relative clauses. Now, relative pronouns are pronouns, and therefore they have antecedents, and the antecedent is going to determine the gender and number of the form of the relative pronoun. And then relative pronouns will have a function inside their clause. For example, if I say something like, this is the man who came to dinner, who is the subject of came? And so the form of who in Greek would have to be what case? Nominative, okay? So the case of my pronoun depends on it, the pronoun's function in the sentence. This is true of all pronouns, by the way, in Greek. So let's take a look at the forms of the relative pronouns. And you have the handout here, but your handout is black and white. What I want to help you see here is that if you know the forms of the article, which you've been working on memorizing dutifully, haven't you? If you know the forms of the article, then really you know how to parse any relative pronoun, because the way the relative pronouns end is exactly the same as the way that the article ends. Or actually, the form of the relative pronoun is, for the most part, the way the relative the article ends. So let's just take a look at these forms here. So looking at the, we'll just stick with the singular forms for a moment. If I want to say something like the man who did something, I'm going to use has as my relative pronoun. Notice, by the way, that I have a rough breathing, right? Got a rough breathing and an accent mark. So this is one characteristic feature of relative pronouns, is that they have both rough breathing and accent mark. You compare that to the article. The article ha, hey and ta, they have either a rough breathing or an accent mark, don't they? But they don't have both. So ha only gets the rough breathing, no accent mark for the. If it doesn't begin with a rough breathing, it's going to have a tau, right? You remember this about the article? Mm-hmm. All forms of the article begin with tau except for four. Ha, hey, hoy, hi. Those don't have a tau, but they get a rough breathing. If they have a rough breathing, they don't have an accent. If they have a tau, there's no rough breathing, but there is an accent. So you get one or the other. Okay? Not true with relative pronouns. They get both rough breathing and accent mark, always on the same thing, always on the same form. So has, compare that to ha. How is this similar? Well, the O is similar, right? The omicron. Except this one gets a sigma, which is really, we would expect the article to have a sigma because it's a second declension nominative form, isn't it? Yeah. But if you remember, it's just the omicron hanging all by itself. So that's why I have the sigma in red here. These are the points of difference. Now, to say of whom, the man of whom I speak, I have to put whom in the genitive case, and it's who. Rough breathing, circumflex above the rough breathing. This is a diphthong, remember, so I always put my breathing marks and accents over the second member of the diphthong. Compare that with to. Same letters, right? Same circumflex, but I've got the rough breathing. I have no rough breathing here. Of the is the way I would translate that. Ho, ho, ho. Merry Christmas. There's ho with the iota subscript. That's part of the dative case ending, right? And here, for the article, I get to. So very similar. Oops, didn't mean to mark that out. So basically, if I want to know what the forms of relative pronoun are, basically I go to the article, drop the towels, and put a ref breathing in. That's almost always the case. Pardon the pun. All right, and then Han. The man whom Billy killed is my father. There I'm going to use the accusative case of the relative pronoun, Han, and the article is Tan. So again, very, very much same as the endings of the article are here. Okay, feminine forms. Hey versus hey. Hey, those are the same, aren't they? The difference being I get the rough breathing and the accent mark on the relative. So the woman who did such and such. Hey Gune, hey did some verb. All right, so these are almost identical. Haste and taste. The woman of whom I speak. Hey, with the dative, iota subscript. The woman to whom I sent the letter is my mother. And of course that looks like the second half of the article, te. And then hain and tain. See how easy it would be to parse these relative pronouns if you know your case endings on the article, right? So the woman whom I love is Cheryl. And then the relative pronoun for the neuter singulars. Here I have ha, and over here I have ta. So the common feature is the omicron. Remember, there's no nu at the end of the neuter singular article in the nominative. We would have expected that given second declension forms. No nu here and no nu here, so nothing new. All right, who and ho, to and toe. Magically, they are identical to the masculine forms, aren't they? Because that is one of your noun rules, isn't it? All right, good. So let's say the antecedent of my relative clause and relative pronoun is technon. That would be what gender?
Neuter.
Neuter. But that means child, right? So the child who ate spinach, right? I would use the neuter form. The child of whom, who, I speak. The child to whom, ta technon ho. The child to whom I sent the letter. And the child whom I love, ha. Okay. All of these have rough breathings and accent marks. Looking at the feminine forms of the relative pronoun, looky, looky here. Hoi, the men who love Greek, hoi. And the article for the masculine plural things, hoi. They sound the same. This one's got the accent. This one does not. The men of whom is hon, and of course that's just like tone, except when you drop the towel you have to add the ref breathing. Okay, the men to whom, hois, and the men whom I love, hus, tus. Same forms after the towel. All right, feminine forms of the relative, everybody. Hi, say that with me. Hi.
Hi.
And it's just like the feminine plural article, hi, except I've got the accent mark on the relative pronoun. So the women who study Greek. Hone, look at that, same as this, right? Same as the neuter. Just like tone, tone, and tone are all the same. So you're not going to be able to tell the difference. The omega always swallows up the stem vowels that you normally see. So you can't tell. So how will you know what gender hone is? Look at the antecedent noun, right? Because I'm going to have some noun of whom such and such happens. Okay, everybody, heis is parallel to the article tice, except I get the rough breathing and the tap. Okay, so the women to whom I sent the letter, and then the accusative plural feminine, everybody, has. Compare that with toss, right? So the women whom we love. And then the neuter plurals. Ha,
ha
reflects ta without the tau, right? The children who love Greek. Hon, the children of whom I speak, and that's like tone, right? ha hon ta to. Hois,
hois
is like hois, by the way, over here in the masculine. The children to whom I sent letters, like twice, and then ha,
ha
and ta, and we're back to the identical forms in the neuter, nominative, and accusative, right? And that's another one of your noun rules. Okay. So those observations we've been making here. So on the next page, you don't really need to look at that. We've already talked about that. Let's now take a look at the actual situations where we'll see these in real sentences, and we'll point out things that Mounts discusses in 14.8 and following. Okay, so the second page of your two-page handout should have these little notes. So case, gender, and number of relative pronouns. Relative pronouns will have case, gender, and number. They're marked for all three, just like articles are marked for all three. They do follow the 2-1-2 pattern, so you're already familiar with all those. The gender and the number is based on the antecedents, gender and number. Let me go ahead and just tell you that another term for the antecedent when we're talking about relative clauses, the antecedent can also be referred to as the head, okay? So the head and the antecedent, I use those terms synonymously. The head is the noun that's being modified by relative clause. Relative clauses are adjectival, by the way. They modify nouns. The head noun or the antecedent noun is what's being modified by relative clause. The case of the relative pronoun is based on the relative pronoun's function, and this is really important in the relative clause. The relative pronoun has a role inside the relative clause. It not only introduces the relative clause, but it has a syntactic role, a grammatical role, inside the relative clause. So the relative clause, because it's a clause, clauses have verbs. Clauses have verbs, and verbs have subjects and sometimes objects and adverbs and other things like that, prepositional phrases, and the relative pronoun is going to have some grammatical role inside the relative clause in some way relative to the verb that's inside the relative clause. So when you have a relative clause, and I think we talked about this when we talked about independent clauses and dependent clauses, right? Remember how we talked about that? I think it's when we started learning about hati clauses. Mm-hmm. Okay. So clauses can be independent and dependent. A relative clause is a dependent clause. And dependent clauses sit inside of independent clauses that can stand on their own. And if you have an independent clause with a dependent clause embedded in it, how many verbs are you going to have in your sentence? You're going to have two verbs. Now, one of the verbs might be the implied copular verb, right? It could be the form of to be that's unstated but implied. But there's going to be a verb, explicit or implicit. There's going to be actually two. And there's going to be subjects of those verbs that might be explicitly written or they might be implicitly there, right? And so forth. So you're going to have to make sure that you keep the elements of the dependent clause together and that you analyze the grammar of the dependent clause on its own terms. And inside your relative clause, which is a dependent clause, your relative pronoun is going to have some role inside that dependent relative clause. Okay, and we're going to look at some examples of this. So this may all sound like gibberish right now, but it will all be clear in about 10 seconds. Case, gender, number of relative pronouns here. Let's look at some examples, okay? So here I have a sentence that in Greek means the hour which is coming is here. Okay, look at that that sentence. What is the relative clause in English?
Which is
which is coming. Good. So I'm going to go ahead and just draw a bracket here around the relative clause. What is not in brackets is my independent clause. The independent clause is the hour is coming, right? I'm sorry. Wrong. The hour is here. That sentence can stand on its own, right? That's what gives it the character of an independent clause. On the other hand, the dependent clause, which happens to be a relative clause, which is coming, I can't just say that to somebody all by itself, can I? So this is dependent. It needs an independent clause to sit inside of. How many verbs do I have then in this whole sentence?
Two.
I have two, right? This is the main verb of the independent clause is, and this is the verb of the dependent relative clause. Okay? All right. Now, here's how it reads in Greek, and you can repeat after me. Hey hora.
Hey hora.
Hey erchetai.
Hey erchetai.
Estin hode.
Estin hode.
All right. So, the hour which is coming is here. So again, let me switch up my color here. Hey erchetai is my relative clause. My independent clause, hey hora estin hode, right? The hour is here. Now, here's my relative pronoun, hey. Okay? The gender and number of hey is what?
Feminine
and singular. And why is it feminine and singular? Yes, the antecedent hora is feminine and singular. This relative clause is modifying something. What's it modifying? Yeah, it's modifying the hora, right? It's telling you something about the hour. What about the hour? Well, that hour's coming, right? That's what it's telling you about it. So which hour? The hour that's coming. That's the one. What about that hour? Well, it's here, right? So this is feminine singular, this pronoun, because the antecedent or the head. Okay, so here, we'll write that down too. So the head or the antecedent is feminine singular. Now, looking inside the relative clause itself, I have a verb, and hey is functioning how in relation to this verb? What is hey's function? The pronoun which. It is the subject, isn't it? What is coming? Well, the which is coming, right? The which, that is the relative pronoun, is the same gender and number as the head, because the two are equal to each other, aren't they? If I were to take the relative pronoun, remember, pronouns do what? How do we typically define a pronoun in our traditional grammar classes? Pronouns take the place of a noun, right? And that means that the pronoun and the thing that the pronoun takes the place of are identical to each other, aren't they? Here's a really fancy word that you might want to know if you're ever on Jeopardy. They are coreferential. Isn't that a beautiful word? They are coreferential. The antecedent and the relative pronoun are coreferential. That means that they refer to the same thing. So if I were to take the word hora, which is the head or the antecedent, and replace the pronoun with that head or antecedent, I would be saying the same thing, right? It is the hour is coming, isn't it? It's the hour that's here, and it's the hour that's coming. So the same word is being used. Here it's being used as an explicit noun, here it's being used as a pronoun, but it refers to the same thing, all right? It's the subject of erchetai, and if it's the subject, it has to be what case? Nominative. Okay? Now, it just so happens that the antecedent or head is nominative because it's the subject of this verb, isn't it? But they don't have to match case. They don't have to match case. It's just an accident that these match case here. Let's take a look at this other example. Why don't you repeat after me? Legato anthropo.
Legato anthropo.
Han agapa ha Jesus.
Han agapa ha Jesus.
All right. So this is translated as he speaks to the man whom Jesus loves. Okay? So where does my relative clause begin? Begins with the relative pronoun han. Okay? And it ends with? Yes, Jesus. Good. So my independent clause is outside the relative clause. The relative clause is embedded in the main or the independent clause. So I could say he speaks to the man, and I could have stopped there, put my period there, and I'd have a good grammatical sentence, wouldn't I? Because independent clauses can stand on their own. But if I were to start a sentence with whom and go to Jesus loves and say whom Jesus loves, that wouldn't make a whole lot of sense, okay? Because dependent clauses cannot stand on their own. They have to be embedded inside independent clauses. Now, han is my relative pronoun. Looking at the omicron, what gender do you think that is? It's going to be masculine or neuter, right? With the nu, this tells me that it must be masculine because there are no neuter forms of the relative pronoun that end with a nu. Remember that? We go back to our relative pronoun chart. Look at your relative pronouns here in the neuter side. There are no omicron nus, are there? But on the masculine side, we do have the accusative singular masculine form. So back to what we're looking at. This is masculine singular. Okay? Why is it masculine singular? Why did the Greek writer have to choose a masculine singular form? Because the head or the antecedent is masculine singular. He speaks to the man, right? That is a masculine singular noun. And the han that refers to that masculine singular noun must also be masculine singular. But what case is to anthropo? Exactly. This is dative case. What case is han here? It's accusative case. Does the relative pronoun match the case of the antecedent here? It does not. And here's the big question. Why? Why does it not match? Why is han in the accusative case? Well, if you look at the verb agapa, okay, there's my verb inside the relative clause. What's the subject of agapa? Who's doing the loving here? Ha Jesus. How do I know it's ha Jesus? The case. What case is ha Jesus? That's nominative case, isn't it? So this is the subject. Jesus loves. Han is not the subject, as it was in the other example. Han is the direct object of the love, right? So he speaks to the man whom, here I'm using good proper English, right? Whom, that's whenever your relative pronoun is the object of something. That's objective case. The man whom Jesus loves. If I were to replace my relative pronoun with the head noun or the antecedent noun, I would be saying Jesus loves the man. Isn't that the idea here? Yeah. I'm speaking to the man and Jesus loves the man. Now that would just be so repetitive to go around and never use a relative clause, right? This is my wife. I love my wife. I'd rather say this is my wife whom I love, right? And so we use what's called a relativization strategy to, make these co-referential nouns turn one into a relative pronoun and we embed it inside the other clause. That's how this works. So just because my head is one case doesn't mean that the relative pronoun that refers to it is the same case. I always am looking for how does the relative pronoun function relative to the verb inside the relative clause. Is it the object? Is it the subject? Or is it the object of a preposition that has a role inside the relative clause? Right? If it's an object of a preposition, then its case will be determined by the preposition's requirements for its object, right? Because prepositions have different cases that they require the object of the preposition to be in. All right, so that's how relative pronouns and relative clauses work in Greek. Whenever you come across a clause, a relative clause, make sure that you keep all the elements together in it, okay? The direct object of the verb inside the relative clause is not going to be necessarily the object of the verb outside the relative clause. The subject of the verb inside the relative clause is not necessarily going to be the subject of the verb outside the relative clause, okay? So look for where the relative clause begins and ends, and what I would recommend you do, just like I've done here, is to try to bracket the relative clause out. Relative clauses can be removed from your sentence, and your sentence will still be a good grammatical sentence for the most part, okay? And if you can sort of isolate the relative clause and set it on the shelf for a minute, then what's left is your main clause. A lot of times, understanding what the basic sentence is easier to do if you can sort of pull out those non-essential things and say, okay, what's my basic sentence structure? And then now you can fit the relative clause in. Because the relative clause is just going to be modifying some noun that's part of the main clause, okay? And I'll show you how I do this when we look at the exercises. Okay. Well, believe it or not, we've covered the chapter here. I should tell you that there's one situation where you're going to have relative clauses and there isn't going to be an antecedent or a head, okay? And you're going to see this on page 116. Go to go to 14.10 and 14.11. There's some examples of this, okay? The first example in 14.10, he writes here, Hos u lambane. So Hos u lambane. Now, where is the head or antecedent of that relative clause? Hos u lambane ton stauron. There's not one, right? If there were one, it would go right before, okay? That's usually where the antecedents or heads go. They go right before the relative pronoun. So what this is this is a relative clause without a head. I like to call these headless relative clauses, okay? This is a headless relative clause. So here's what you can do. When a Greek sentence employs a headless relative clause, what you are invited to do is to supply mentally and obviously from the context some head that makes sense. You could say something like, okay, remember we're translating Hos as who, which, or that. The one who does not take up his cross. Okay? So here, the function of the relative clause who is still adjectival. It's still modifying a head, but the head is not there. It's implied. Okay? So, how does Jesus know to use the masculine singular form of has here? Well, because the implied head is masculine singular for any person. Okay? Here, masculine singular covers any person. How does Jesus know to use the nominative form of the relative pronoun? Because he's smart, because he created Greek, and because has is the subject of the verb inside the relative clause. Okay. So you could say the one who, you could also say he who, right? So again, you're still supplying some appropriate head here. And then I guess it's possible in English. We don't really like to do this anymore, but let me write for you here one sentence that would have been said some years ago, but I don't think people would say it very much anymore. Who laughs last? You know this expression? Laughs best, right? Okay, so who laughs last is a relative clause. Okay? There is a head that is implied by the relative clause. We could translate this or reword it as the one who laughs last, laughs best, right? So my main verb is laughs. I've got an adverb over here, right? And the null head, the unwritten head, is the subject, and this relative clause is modifying the unstated and implied head. Okay? All right. So you're going to see this in Greek, and 14.10 gives you one example of that. 14.11, oh no, he uses the same example. Has ulambani.
I mean, that's fine too.
What's that?
Whoever.
Okay, I mean, yeah, you could use whoever, but in Greek, there's actually a particle of contingency that can be added to a relative pronoun to explicitly mark it as whoever. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. When you have a headless relative clause in Greek, it's going to be used in situations where the head's unstated, and whoever the head could be is how can I put it? It's sort of up for grabs. That is to say, there's no single person that is actually in the mental representation of the one speaking. Right? In other words, anybody could fulfill the role of who that head is. So if you take a look at this example, has ulambane tan stauran autu, right? The one who does not take up his cross and follow me. Who is that? Does Jesus have a specific person in mind? No. It's really any sort of person that this describes.
So you would translate that the one who does
not? I could translate it as the one who or he who. But the identity of that one or he is not specified, right? No one knows who that is at the time of the utterance of it. That's probably why Mounts translates it as whoever. Yeah. Now, there are forms of the relative pronoun like this, has, tis, okay? So you see the has part, that's the relative pronoun. You see the tis part? That's the indefinite, tis, right? And so when you have those together, definitely you could translate that as whoever, okay? So that's making it explicit. Here it's just has, but in the context, the identity of the head is still contingent. It's not specific.